Okay, here we're looking at the new 7-inch touchscreen on the end of the armrest in a new S-Series combine. Over on the left, you've got several items that you can choose for performance items to watch as you're going through the field. You simply touch the square that you'd like to change, and then use the arrows to highlight the one you want, and then touch it, and it will put it in there, and you can watch it on the go. There's several different things that you can change it to, and you can adjust those to your specific taste and what you'd like to view as you're going through the field. The rest of it is kind of our combine main screen. It's similar to a 70 series in layout. I've got my moisture at the top. I've got my yield. Now right now it's showing average because my header is off, or if your header is raised it will show an average. If you let the header down and you have the separator and header running, it will switch to an instantaneous or at that moment yield and moisture. Down below I have all my combine settings. I've got my cylinder speed, I've got my concave setting, my fan speed, my sieve, and my chaffer. So right now if I would like to adjust my concave, I simply come over here on my armrest and I hit concave, and it will bring up a plus and a minus button and give me an indication of where my concave is set. This is my current setting on 28. If I hit the button, I can start increasing it by hitting the plus sign. This is my ideal set point, and then this is where the concave is currently set. So I keep hitting the plus sign and it will slowly move the concave to where I want it. After 5 seconds of non-activity, the plus and minus sign will go away, or I can simply hit the check mark at any given time to adjust that. Down below, I have a 3/4 full warning. I have my unloading auger on warning. I have my clock, and as well as my recording. The button we're currently working with right now is letter F. We have several other buttons, and we will cover each one of those separately. Okay, now we're going to work with letter G, which is our crop. This will change. If you have a corn head hooked to the machine, it will change to an ear of corn. If you have a platform attached, it will look like this head of wheat. So we're going to go ahead and hit letter G. And it brings us into some of our crop settings. Right now, if we have a check mark in the wet box, it will give us wet bushels. If we want to see dry bushels shown on our yield monitor, then we want to hit letter B, and that will make it change over to dry bushels. And it's given us a minimum and a maximum. So right now, it would show if we were in the field and we had a minimum yield of a given point and the maximum yield that the yield monitor saw at a given point. Same thing with moisture. Right now it's got a minimum moisture and a maximum moisture, showing me the highest and lowest moisture that the combine has seen in the field. And then this is my header width. Now notice it says setup in GreenStar Pro. We currently have a GS2 or GS3 display connected to the machine, so this will be set up in your GS2 or GS3 monitor. Now I have another button over here under the crop button. I'm going to go ahead and touch it. That takes us to where we are right now. If I want to go back to my combine main screen, I hit letter F, and now I'm back at my combine main screen. Okay, now we're going to go look at our set point. This is what we've had in the past where you could automatically set your chaffer and sieve and concave and fan and cylinder speed with the touch of one button to the book settings or to a preset that you've loaded into the machine. So I'm going to go ahead and hit the set point button right here, letter H. And it brings up right now, it says corn, and these are the current settings in the book. So it says for corn, for dry. Now again, that just means that what I consider dry corn, so we're probably talking somewhere in that 20% range or below. If your corn is wetter than that, the book settings you probably need to set wet, and it will change the cylinder and concave and fan settings to match those crop conditions to the book settings. So right now I've got my wet corn selected. It shows all the presets and what they're going to go to. I engage my separator. I do not have to engage my header, but I do have to engage my separator. I need to go to the fast idle position on my throttle, and then I'm going to hit the auto button. And what that will do is that will go ahead and set all the settings to the book settings. And that's what I'm doing right here on letter G. Now letter H. This is my seed size setup. When you set the crop, it will automatically put in a seed size of 70 or whatever that crop sets. You don't really have to change this. It will, should be done automatically. The next one down, letter I, this is my moisture correction. Again, for those of you that had 70 series combines are familiar with this, let's say that the combine on a given load said it was 20% moisture. I took that load to the elevator and they said it was 19. Then what I would need to do is I would need to put in a negative 1. So 19 is 1 less than 20, so I hit that. I put in a minus 1, and I hit enter, and now my moisture correction will lower what it perceives as the moisture by 1. Same thing, if I had the combine show 20%, the elevator said 21, I would need to put in a positive 1, not a negative, a positive 1, to raise that moisture to match what the elevator said. Letter A, this is my grain tank level and my unloading rate offset. You will get, it will show how what your grain tank level is, and that's based on what the yield monitor is showing and based on how much the unloading auger, it thinks the unloading auger has unloaded. So over time, if I have worn augers or if my yield monitor is not calibrated, I may need to change this a little bit for my unloading rate offset, so it will give me an estimated, a more accurate estimated grain tank level. Now, when I get the grain tank full, or what, when I want the warning that says, hey, this grain tank is full so I don't spill corn, when I get the grain tank to that position, I want to come over here and hit letter D, and it will record that many bushels as what you're considering it is full. You know, different grain tank sizes and things of that nature are going to make that necessary. Letter B, this is my grain tank fold and unfold for my automatic grain tank covers. If I want to unfold them, I would select this button. If I want to fold them, I would hit this button. And again, there is a quick button on the armrest that we'll cover later, but that would be how you would fold or unfold your grain tank hoppers. Right now it's telling us the chopper position is lowered. That's going to be, for the most part, that's going to be all the choppers that we're going to cover. There are some other options that you can get on a chopper that you might be able to change in here, but for the standard chopper, which is 99% of what we sell, that's going to be what you're going to find on that button. The last button is the Harvest Smart, to where the combine will adjust speed based on yield loss, based on engine load, based on rotor, how full the rotor is, things of that nature. And that right now it's in the off position. If I want to change that, I have to hit the button on the armrest to change it to capacity mode, which it's going to ignore grain loss and it's just going to go off of the rotor load and the engine load. I hit it again, it's back to off, and then I have a smart position. This one actually, you tell it max engine power is 90%, don't go over that. Grain loss calibration, so you calibrate your loss monitor, which we'll do later. And once you get all that set, you can tell it I don't want to go any faster than 6.2, and then the combine will speed up and slow down based on field and ground conditions. To get out of all this, if I want to go back to my main screen, I go back to letter F, and we'll continue with the next section. Okay, now we're looking in the header portion of the monitor, and it says it's hooked to a corn head, and we've got a 12 row corn head connected to it. It's had a corn head on it for 2/10 of an hour, and it will keep track of what type of head and how long, many hours that header has been connected. Now, it doesn't specifically go say that, okay, it was that serial number of header. It just knows that it's had a corn head or another type of header on it. Currently, we've got it set up for a 12 row 30, and you would want to configure that to whatever your header is. Your record stop height is the same as always. It turns your recording on and off. However, if you have a header that has sensing on it, this now becomes irrelevant, and it will go off of when you use number 2 or number 3 to let your header down and it sees those sensors on the ground, that's when it's going to turn your recording on and off. So we don't really have to worry about this anymore as long as we've got a header with some kind of header control on it. Now over here I've got another button that's called auto, so I need to set up my auto header functions. I hit letter H, and right now I've got a corn head on it. So this is my header height sensing. This is my header height resume. This is my deck plates. And this is my contour master. And I notice that all of those are checked. And that's what I want to make sure that all of that is done. So again, when I put a platform on it, it probably would have the reel also highlighted. And I would want to make sure that it would have a check mark. This button, the one with the wavy line underneath of the platform, we will never use unless it is a rigid platform that we're using a header float. And I don't know that anybody in Central Illinois is going to ever use that feature. So this is only for header float, and we will not use that feature on our machines. Now we want to go over a couple things on the engine button. I'm going to go to letter J. I'm going to hit the engine button. This is the isochronous engine. I want to make sure that I'm running the engine between the green and the yellow position. I don't want to get it up into the red. If I get it up into the top end of the yellow or the red, my rotor is starting to slow down, my cleaning shoe is starting to slow down, and I'm going to lose some capacity in the field. This is the engine hours. This is the separator hours. Down at the bottom is something important that we need to note. This is the exhaust filter cleaning from the new emissions that are now on the new machines. I never want to have this on the disable. I always want to have it on auto. You won't notice any difference in performance. You won't notice any difference at all in the machine, other than there'll be a little bitty icon up here on the corner post. So you always want to make sure this is in the check. If you would uncheck it and put it to disable, what that can lead to down the road is the engine may derate if it's going long enough without doing the regeneration. And you may have to have a technician come out and do about a 45 minute to 3 hour cleaning of your engine without being able to run it. So make sure this is always in the auto position. Now we're going to do the feeder house raise calibration. Under my calibrations, I want to select it in my white box here. I'm going to hit the enter, and it says engine running at high idle. So I'm going to go to high idle. I'm going to lower my header all the way to the ground. I'm going to hit the enter button. All right, now it says lower feeder house resting on the ground. Select the next step. Press and hold the header raise switch. Continue holding the header raise switch. And you'll notice the values at the bottom of the screen continue to rise. And what it's doing is it's just opening that valve just a little bit at a time till it figures out that it's actually moving, so that it'll have a smooth response whenever you hold the button up or hold the button down. Now it's coming all the way to the top. All right, now I'm going to go to the lower. Again, you can see the values at the bottom are starting to open. Now the header's starting to move just a little bit. Continue to hold the switch as the values continue to change. All right, now back to header raise. Now back to header lower. Header raise. Header lower. Calibration complete. So we'll hit the enter button. Okay, now we're going to do a header calibration. We need to have the combine on relatively level ground, and we need to have the engine running at fast idle. So we're going to go to high idle, and we're going to hit accept under letter B. Okay, lower feeder house with the header resting on the ground. So I'm going to go to my hydro handle. I'm going to manually lower the header all the way to the ground, so it's completely resting all the way to the header on the ground. Once I get that done, I'm going to hit the next step button. Now it says press and hold the header raise switch. I'm going to press and hold the header raise switch. It's going to raise the head, and it's going to find the range of those sensors. The calibration is complete. I want to make sure and hit enter to accept it. some performance tuning. And what it's going to do is it's just going to kind of fine tune it. So I go to my next step, A, letter A. I'm going to press and hold the header lower switch. And it's going to kind of raise and lower that header really fast to try to find out what the response is. So it's going to bounce you around a little bit. So it took care of that. My calibration's complete. I hit the enter button. And I've just saved my header calibration in my monitor. Okay, now we're going to do the feeder house tilt speed. And again, we want to combine on level ground. We've got to have it running at high idle, so we'll go fast idle. I hit my next step or enter button. Okay, we're going to raise the feeder house. We're going to raise it all the way up. So now it says press and hold the header tilt left. So on my hydro handle, I hold it left. Now it just switched and said press and hold the right switch. So I'm going to manually try to tilt my header to the right. Now it may not move initially, but it's going to do. You notice the numbers changing at the bottom. It's just slowly opening that valve until it starts sensing some motion. Then it's going to go ahead and finish the calibration. Notice the numbers are continuing to rise. Now it's just starting to get a little bit of motion out of it. So now it's just continue holding the switch. Now we're going to go back left. Again, it's just starting to fine-tune those numbers. Again, just be patient with it because it's not going to move initially when you push the button. It's got to get the numbers up to where it'll start having enough pressure allowed, enough oil allowed through the valve to go ahead and let it calibrate. So it's starting to move the header a little bit now. It's starting to tilt it to the left. All right, now we're going to go back to the right. Again, what it's doing, it's just slowly tuning in that valve so it has a better idea of what and how that head's going to react so that you'll get a smooth performance in the field. So now we're going back left. Head's starting to tilt left again. Now we're going to go back right. Now we're going to go back left. Calibration is complete. Okay, we're looking at the corner post on the new S-Series combine, and we've got several new things that have not been on previous models, and we'll start here on the left. It's got a kilowatt for the engine. These combines have what we call an isochronous engine, which the RPMs, when you engage a separator, go to a set level, and that's going to vary depending on which model you have. But it's kind of a power meter. You got a green, a yellow, and a red. And as long as you're running in the green or maybe a little bit in the yellow, you're using that combine to its max efficiency. You get it up in the red, you're going to start to pull the RPMs down below rated. If you do that, your cleaning shoe, your rotor, and those kind of things are going to start slowing down. You're going to lose some capacity. So what you want to do going through the field is just watch this little power meter right here and keep it kind of between the green and yellow right there. Try not to get it in the red, and you'll be maxing out your efficiency. Right here we've got our fuel level in the middle, and that's what this flashing warning light is right now. We don't have a lot of fuel in this brand new combine. The next one over is our water temperature. Pretty self-explanatory there. Here's our engine RPM right here, and then this is our actual ground speed. Now there's a couple more things over here. This happens to be an S680, and it has the ProDrive transmission. And right now it's showing that we are in park. There's a park button on the armrest, which we'll cover later, that you engage and disengage park with. There's no longer a park pedal. And also on your ProDrive you have two ranges. Right now we're in range one, and that's where we're set it. You can set a top speed, kind of like an IVT. You can set a top speed in range one, and then you can set a top speed in range two, and then move the hydro handle in between those for an infinite variable speed in between those two ranges. Okay, down here we've got our header controls will be in this area, and then down below we have our vision track or our loss monitor that we've had on previous model combines. The icons for each specific head will appear right here when you're connected to that head. And then this is going to show your position of that head. Your contour master is there all the time, giving you a manual visual of where the head is based on its tilt. Now down below I've got my cleaning shoe, I've got my rotor loss, and then in the middle I've got my composite, just like I had since the 50 series combines. And then over here I've got my tailings. This number is going to mean different things. Right now with no head, it's my feeder house position. When I get if I have a non-Hydroflex header on it, it'll give me my range within my sensors on my head. If I have a Hydroflex platform on it, then it's going to give me my pressure of my Hydroflex. Okay, here we're looking at the new hydro handle, and really it's very similar to what we've had in the past. They have added one new button, and we'll cover them all here right now. We still have our 1, 2, and 3 button. If we're using a header that does not have sensing on it in any way, then the 1, 2, and 3 button will be header height resume, and they're using the sensor on the feeder house, so there won't be any ground contact. So you can set 1, 2, or 3 in any position that you would like. Now, if you have a header that has some kind of a ground sensing, whether it be a corn head or Hydroflex platform or whatever that might be, 1, 2, and 3 are going to be different things. Number one will always be raise with a sensing header. 2 and 3 will be to my return to cut. You can set number 2 and number 3 at a different height position, for example, on a corn head, or you can set them for different pressures if you're running a Hydroflex platform. So I could set, you know, for example, I could set number 2 on a corn head, maybe set it at my normal height, and then number 3, maybe I set that to a different height for my down corn or something of that nature. I've got my up and down and 4 and a half for my platform reel. On a corn head, this would be my header speed up and down, and then my deck plate opening right here. This is my manual header up and down and my manual header tilt. With this switch, my unloading auger has several different positions. It's got a first click is for manually extending the unloading auger. If I click it all the way, it will automatically swing the unloading auger all the way out. Same thing coming back. I can click it once, and it will manually pull the unloading auger in until I let off the switch. If I want it to swing all the way in, I hit the switch all the way to detent, and it will go ahead and swing the unloading auger all the way in. This button still engages my unloading auger. Hit it again, and it will disengage my unloading auger. Still have my quick stop button on the top. And if I hit that, that's going to disengage my header as well as disengage the unloading auger. Okay, now we're looking at the armrest on our new S-Series combine. Of course, we've got our two header and separator switches up here. Those really haven't changed since the 50 series came out. I've got my header switch on the left, my separator switch on the right. Push down and forward to turn your separator on. Down and forward to turn your header on. And if I want to use my reverser, simply shut my header off. Push down and pull and hold back will reverse my head and eject the crop that's plugged the feeder house or the header. This button is for my Smart, Harvest Smart. There's three settings. There's off, there's smart, which takes care of and takes into account your loss, your engine load, as well as your separator load. Capacity mode takes only into account your separator load and your engine load. And then off, of course, is it's not enabled. I still have my three position throttle, slow, middle, and high idle. I have some new buttons for those of you who have never had a Pro Drive before. I've got a park, I've got a diff lock, and I've got 1 and 2. Now obviously my park button, I don't have a pedal on the floor anymore, so if I want to engage or disengage park, I simply hit the button. The indicator is up on the corner post, so if I hit the park button, the red park button light up on the corner post will go away. If I hit it again to engage park, the red park button light will appear up on the corner post. 1 and 2 are for my Pro Drive. I have mode 1 and mode 2. Mode 1 is going to be for most of my harvesting conditions. And once I set mode 1 up on the armrest, I'll be able to set the max speed in mode 1. Mode 2 is another setting, and many times the max speed to that is set to my highway travel speed. The next one is my diff lock. Obviously, it locks my differential together, so both front duals spin at the same time. These are my knobs for adjusting my hydroflex pressure or my header height. If I'm on a corn head, I simply turn it clockwise or counterclockwise to adjust my header height or adjust the pressure in my hydroflex platform. This is my dial speed. My automatic reel speed is on the back button. If I want my reel to turn faster or slower in relationship to the ground speed I'm traveling, then I will use this button, again, clockwise for faster, counterclockwise for slower. This is my transport lock. If I press this button and a little light comes on, that means none of my header functions will work and my unloading auger will not swing. The back one is for the grain tank fold. If I have the automatic or the folding grain tank set up, I hit this button and it will fold the grain tanks automatically, or if they're folded, you hit the button and it will unfold the grain tank automatically. All right, now I'm looking at the three-speed transmission in a 660, 670, or 550 combine. I've got a park button, I've got a 1, a 2, and a third gear. To get it out of park, I hit the P button, and up on the corner post there'll be a red P, and if it's in park, the P light will be there. If it is not in park, the red P will go away. If I want to select my first range, I press the 1 button, and again, up on the corner post, there will be a 1, 2, 3 indicator. If I want to go to second gear, I hit the 2 button. If I want to go to the third gear, I hit the 3 button. Now, I do have to be stopped in order to be able to shift between 1, 2, or 3. If I want to put the combine back in park, I simply move the hydro handle to the neutral position, and it will engage the park brake. If I dismount the combine, I want to go ahead and hit the button to make sure that I lock the park brake permanently. So again, to get it out of park, I just simply hit the button on the armrest, I select my gear range, and then I can move my hydro handle out of neutral and proceed through the field. Okay, now we're looking at the right-hand portion of our armrest. This is new to the S-Series combine. It's probably familiar to you if you've been in an 8R or a 9R series tractor. And I've got several buttons over here. I've got my home button, my menu button, my cancel button, and my check mark or accept button. I've got my scroll wheel, which will move the highlighted box on the screen. And then I've got A through J, which correspond to different buttons or different functions on the display in the combine. If you have the touchscreen display, which is how Sloan Implement sets up all their machines, likely you will not use these buttons too often. But just be mindful if you're speaking with a technician or something this is the check mark, the cancel, the menu, the home button, your scroll wheel, as well as your A through J buttons. Now over here I've got 6 buttons that are used to set the settings on the combine. The first one is my Hydroflex pressure. Now I will only use this button if I'm locking up the head for wheat or if I'm calibrating the header. And it's used to turn the Hydroflex pressure all the way up or turn it down below 1,000 so I can calibrate my header. So this button was only used during calibration or locking for wheat. These are my sensitivity button. If I press it once, I set my manual raise and lower sensitivity. I press it again, I set my header height, so just my ground contact sensor sensitivity. If I press it a third time, then it will do the tilt sensitivity. There's manual raise and lower. There's my header height sensitivity. There's my tilt. And then I have my automatic tilt is the fourth and final sensitivity setting with this button. This button is my cylinder speed. I press the button. Now I can use the plus or minus sign on the screen to adjust my concave or rotor or whatever button I select. This one is my concave. These are my chaffer and sieve. I press it once is my chaffer adjust. I press it a second time is my sieve adjust. And then of course this is my fan speed setting, so I press it once and I use the plus and minus sign on the screen to adjust my fan speed up or down. Now we're looking at the back portion of the right hand armrest that's new for the S-Series combines. I've got my fan control, I've got auto, and then the infinite range of my fan. I've got my temperature setting, I've got a defrost button, and I've got an air conditioning button. I want to make sure that if I need air conditioning that this button is on. You must have the engine running for the light to appear. We just have the key on right now, but make sure that the snowflake has a light next to it to make sure that your air conditioning is going to work. These are some of my extra field lights right here. This is my automatic flashing light, my rotary light. And that auto means that if my grain tank gets full, the rotary light will turn on. And then this is rotary light on full time. So if I was going to go down the road or something, I would want to use this button. And then this is my standard hazard light button. This is the overhead panel in the S-Series combines. I do have a map light right here. This is for my heated mirrors. I also have a power mirror adjust. I've got left and right, and then I move the knob to adjust the mirrors to fit what I'm looking for. This is the radio that has a CD player in it. To set the clock, you're going to hold the display and time button until you get the hour to flash, and then you use the turn knob to adjust the hours. You'll hit display time again, then you can adjust the minutes as well as the AM and PM. But that's going to have you set your clock. The radio functions are pretty self-explanatory, from the scan to setting your presets and things of that nature. Okay, we're taking a look at the turn signal. They've moved a lot of functions out there now. Not only do I still have my normal turn signal functions, you know, right turn and left turn, but I also have my lights out here. I've got off, my parking lights, field lights, and field light 2 are all right out here on the end of my turn signal. I also have my wipers off. I've got my intermittent wipers, my full-time wiper, and then my wash. My washer is all the way down here. I also have bright light, flash, and for my bright lights as well as my dim lights. And then my horn is out on the end of the stick. Underneath the instruction seat is a refrigerator to keep your beverages cold or your lunch cold. And to access it, you can simply flop down the front cover to access it, or the top also folds up. Now this only stays cold when the key is on. When the key is off, it will not stay cold. So if you're going to leave the combine overnight, you probably want to take things with you because it will not be refrigerated overnight. But that's underneath the instructional seat. Okay, for your business band radio, the cabs come pre-wired for a business band radio. To find that coax cable for your business band radio, you're going to remove the cup holder, and then in behind the cup holder you'll find the coax cable already assembled, ready to plug into your radio. The first time you install a GS2 or a GS3 in an S-Series combine, you likely will get this warning which says John Deere display detected. What you really need to do, if you get this warning and it's the first time you've plugged in a GS2 or GS3, just shut the machine down, let all both displays power down, and then restart the engine, and then all the functions that belong on the GS2 or GS3 will be there, and then everything that is not supposed to be there will be located on the mini screen. So that's what this warning is all about, and that's how we correct it.